I'm honored to be here, and I would like to thank the Academy. I come from Ireland, and the three poems I'm going to read are just really brief gestures towards the huge complexities and darknesses, sometimes of a small country. The first poem also gestures towards the United States, with which Ireland has had so many and such powerful connections over the years. But it's a story that I would have heard in my childhood that perhaps my own children won't hear now. It's called The Lost Art of Letter Writing. In the many years there were before there was internet or communications or even telephones, the Irish people who left Ireland and they went to the United States wrote home. And they wrote home, some of them, every week to a country they would never see again, to people whose faces they would never see again. And that was the reality of emigration. And as time went on, Ireland became a modern state, and so many of those letters just went upstairs into the attics of the homes. And so a country that had been longed for ended up forgotten. This is called The Lost Art of Letter Writing. The ratio of daylight to handwriting was the same as lace making to eyesight. The paper was so thin it skinned air. The hand was fire and the page tinder. Everything burned away, except the one place they singled out between their fingers, held over a letter pad they set aside for the long evenings of their leave takings, always asking after what they kept losing, always performing, even when a shadow fell across the page, and they knew the answer was not forthcoming, the same action. First, the leaning down, the pen becoming a staff to walk the fields with as they vanished underfoot into memory. Then the letting up, the lighter stroke, which brought back cranesbill and thistle, a bicycle wheel rusting, an iron circle hurting the grass again, and the hedges veiled in hawthorn, again just in time for the May novenas recited in sweet air on a road leading to another road and then another one, widening to a motorway with four lanes, ending in a new town on the edge of a city they will never see. And if we say an art is lost when it no longer knows how to teach a sorrow to speak, come and see the way we lost it. Stacking letters in the attic, going downstairs so as not to listen to the fields stirring at night as they became memory, and in the morning as they became ink. And what we did, so as not to hear them whispering the only question they knew by heart, the only one they learned from all those epistles of air and unreachable distance, how to ask, is it still there? This poem is called Quarantine. One of the great lessons learned from a small country, I learned when I was a young poet, and that is, no matter what, the past is not the same as history. And in Ireland, history was so often a story of heroes. It was a story of, rightly, a small country which had prevailed. But the past is a place of whispers and shadows. And the two people of this poem really existed. They turn up in a book called Mishkel Fein, My Own Story, written at the start of the 20th century. A man remembering a tiny village in West Cork in the famine of 1847, how his mother recounted finding a young couple frozen overnight. They'd come back to a cabin from the workhouse, but the man had held his wife's feet against his chest as she died and as he died. The poem is partly a reproach to the genres of literature which don't always include the past and the steadfastness of the people who lived there, quarantine. In the worst hour of the worst season of the worst year of a whole people, a man set out from the workhouse with his wife. He was walking, they were both walking north. She was sick with famine fever and could not keep up. He lifted her and put her on his back. He walked like that, west and west and north, until at nightfall, under freezing stars, they arrived. In the morning, they were both found dead, of cold, of hunger, of the toxins of a whole history. But her feet were held against his breastbone. The last heat of his flesh was his last gift to her. Let no love poem ever come to this threshold. There is no place here for the inexact praise of the easy graces and sensuality of the body. There is only time for this merciless inventory. Their death together in the winter of 1847. Also, what they suffered, how they lived, and what there is between a man and woman, and in which darkness it can best be proved. But the final poem is, I think, something that comes as the gift of those histories, even those personal histories that darken a country. It's called The Emigrant Irish. I wrote it at a time when I was afraid that in Ireland, in a time of prosperity, that we might forget those people who left Ireland and came to the United States. It's sometimes said that the people who leave are the stronger and the more innovative, perhaps, but they also need to live in the memories and the psychic understandings of the people they leave behind, and this is called The Emigrant Irish. Like oil lamps, we put them out the back of our houses, of our minds. We had lights better than and newer than, and then a time came this time, and now we need them. Their dread makeshift example. They would have thrived on our necessities. What they survived, we could not even live. By their lights now, it is time to imagine how they stood there, what they stood with, that their possessions may become our power. Cardboard, iron, their hardships parceled in them, patience, fortitude, long suffering in the bruise-colored dusk of the new world, and all the old songs and nothing to lose. Thank you very much.